Hi everybody, welcome to the first Chatterbox Quilts Live of 2020. I know, hard to believe we're in a new decade already, right? But we are. And it seems like Christmas and New Year's was a long time ago, at least to me it seems that way. But anyway, so if you're joining me here today, thanks so much for taking time out of your busy day to do that. And if you're here, I would also like you to say hi and let me know where you're watching from in the chat area so I can see where you are watching from and where you quilt at, because I'm guessing you're in the same area, unless you're on vacation. And if you are, I hope it's somewhere warm because we are in a deep freeze in Calgary. Yes, we have had, I think, 3 days now of an extreme cold temperature warning. And I think it's probably, I don't know what it is, minus 30 something or other right now Celsius. With the wind chill, it feels like close to minus 40 Celsius, which is pretty cool. We actually set some records, apparently, just I think yesterday. And, you know, I would like to set records, but not that kind. So I hope it's warmer where you are. Or as I said, if you're on vacation, you're somewhere warm. Because, boy, if you were going to go on vacation from Calgary, this would be the week. Thankfully, the cold doesn't last too long here and it's warming up by the weekend. So I think by next Monday, we're going to be in plus temperatures. So go figure. Anyhow, hello Rob, good to see you here, and I see it's a lot warmer there. And hello Deb as well, from Utopia, Ontario. You gotta tell me where that is, Deb, because I haven't heard of that, and I'm from Ontario. So, or are you just saying Ontario's the Utopia? I'm not sure which. But anyway, if that's actually a town, tell me where it is. So, today we're gonna be doing a Q&A session. So, I've got some things to show you, and I get questions from people all the time. You know, the same ones over and over and over again. So I thought we could address some of those. And of course, if you have any specific questions, you can always type them in the chat and I'll get to those today as well. Just outside Barrie. Okay, my parents live in Bracebridge, so I know where that area is for sure. So you got some cold weather heading your way apparently, because our weather usually comes across, so be prepared. If you are one of my chatties watching today, thanks so much for joining me too. And Rob, of course, is one of my TQW members. So I'm going to talk about that a little later in the live stream today. I'm going to talk about TQW a little bit later on today and what's coming up in there, because there's some fun stuff coming up in there too in the next few days. So if you're watching on replay, because I know some of you do that, just put replay in the comments so I'll know that you're watching me after we have finished today. Okay, so let's get right into it here. So I want to start with Janome question, because I'm a Janome kind of gal. You guys know me. I'm a Janome artisan for Janome Canada. And I get frequent questions on a couple of the models all the time. So there is a Janome 9400, which I used to have, and there's a Janome 9450, which is what I currently have. And with the 9400, there was an upgrade you could get with it. So it upgraded some of the software in the machine, and there's also a little kit that came with some new feet, a ruler foot and some other free motion quilting feet. So people seem to be under the misunderstanding that once you get that upgrade on the 9400, that the machine is the same as the 9450. And that is not the case. They're similar, but there are still some differences on the machine, some physical differences really on the two machines. So I thought I would talk about that for a little bit. So if you're not a Janome person or you're not interested, well, do some quilting while I'm talking, but we'll get to some other things that may be more appropriate for you in a few minutes. But the upgrade that you got for the 9400 meant that you could now use a ruler foot on the 9400. And the problem before that was that there was, you could use a ruler foot, but they wouldn't tell you that you should do that because there's an automatic pressure foot lifter on that machine. So when you stop stitching, you can set it so that the foot automatically comes up, or when you start stitching, it would automatically go down. If you put a ruler foot on at the time, the machine didn't know that you had that ruler foot on, and it could move up or down. Up was the issue, actually, and it could cause problems with that ruler foot where it's attached on the machine. So with the upgrade, the machine knew that you had the ruler foot on, it won't do that, it won't cause this issue. So that is the big thing that changed what you could do with the 9400, and of course the ruler foot came with the upgrade kit too, so you actually had the foot because it wasn't included with the 9400. The ruler foot and all the other little feet that you got with the upgrade are included with the 9450. So you think, okay, well then now we're talking the same thing as far as feet. Well, yes and no, because there are some additional feet that come with the 9450. In particular, there's an HP2 foot, which in generic terms is a narrow quarter inch walking foot. It's not quite the right terms when you're talking Janome, but most of us recognize what a walking foot is and how it functions on a machine. So it's a similar thing on the Janomes. I won't get into all the details there because that gets more technical and we need to talk about, but That's one of the extra feet that you get on the 9450 that you don't get with the 9400, even with the upgrade. There's also a different kind of lighting on it. There is still a highlight, which is a retractable light. You can pull it out and push it in. That gives you better visibility. And that's the same on both machines, but there's actually better lighting on the 9450 in the bed of the machine. Also, I have to think about this myself. There's also a tapering feature on the 9450 that the 9400 does not have. So you have the ability to, you know, taper stitches down or taper them up when you're starting on specific stitches on the 9450. The 9400 does not have that at all. We'll never have that. So that's different. So if you like to applique or you want to have that ability to do that with some of your stitches, you'd have to go to the 9450. Let me just see what else I want to make sure I don't miss anything here. The 9450 comes with a separate accessory box. So it's a little box. I can grab it and show you. It's right here. So it gives you more storage is really what that is. So it's going to make some noise. So it has this extra box that comes with it. It has a tray in the top that you can take out and there's more storage underneath. So that's kind of nice. You have some extra storage. Plus you've got the compartment, the arm that goes around the free arm on the machine. It comes with that still as well. So that's something else you don't get on the 9400 is that additional storage box. Let's see here. As far as the stitches go, there are the same stitches on both machines. I was checking that the other day. I thought there was, but I had to double check. So yes, there are the same stitches. So it's not like you get more stitches on the 9450. So just to clarify, if you're one of those people who has a 9400 and you are thinking about doing the upgrade, I think it's a good thing to do because then you can do roller quilting on the machine without having any issues. And you get those additional feet. And some of them are free motion quilting feet as well. Some of the little tiny guys. But if you've just got the 9400 and you're wondering what the differences are from the machines, that's what the differences are. So in my way of thinking, when people ask me, because I get this question a lot as well, I have the 9400. Should I upgrade to the 9450? I don't think so. That's just my own personal thing. If you have an older machine and you're looking at getting a new machine, I would be looking at the 9450. But if you already have the 9400, the differences on them, to my way of thinking, and probably the difference in price is probably not really worth it. I would wait, you know. That's the 9400 is just as good as the 9450. The only thing is there's a few things in there. I don't think it's enough of a difference to upgrade. Now, Deb's asking me, she has the 9400 and she's done the upgrade, great. Is the new workbook still worth having? Because it works with both of them. Yes, it does work with both of them. So if you are looking for a workbook that takes you through some of the if you're looking for a workbook where it has exercises that you can do with the machine to get familiar with it, yes, I think it's worth it. Again, it depends on your level of comfort with your machine already and what you want to learn on, because it'll run you through how to do, you know, buttonholes and everything. It'll run you through the tapering feature, which you won't be able to do with the 9400, of course, but it runs you through all, you know, the variable zigzag, all the different things on the machine that you may not be very familiar with, and it may be helpful for you to have that workbook as well. You know, I'm hearing pros and cons on it. Some people are saying, you know, it needs an index as a table of contents and it doesn't have an alphabetical index. Well, you know, no, it doesn't. But you can certainly go through and it, you know, it builds on things as you go along. There's a sampler quilt in the back of it. So it actually has different blocks that show you different features. You'll actually make it, put it all together into a little quilt top if you want to do that as well. So it does have more information in it than the manual for sure. And it does give you practical exercises that you can do. And this is fairly common with other companies too. They have similar workbooks for their machines. And it just allows you to go through and see what else, or what you can do with it, I should say, if you're not familiar with some of those features. Having said that, I would check and see what the prices are, because I'm seeing prices like all different kinds of prices. So, you know, Deb, I'd check with your local Janome dealer in Barrie and see what they're selling it for. Take a look at it. Take a look at it first. That's why I did the video on it, was so people could take a look at it and see whether, you know, it gives you more information on it, because you can't see it online. There is no PDF version for it. So you can't, you know, go online and like through Amazon, like you can with most books and stuff, and see it. They're not even selling it on Amazon. So you don't have that ability to do it. So my suggestion was you go into your dealer, you take a look at it and see if it's for you or not. If you do sewing, you know, like garment making, that type of thing, home deck stuff, as well as quilting, it's probably going to be helpful for you because it's got all these different features. It's going to run you through everything, other ones that you would use that you might not use when you're quilting, like buttonholes. I want to start using buttonholes in my quilts, but I'm not sure, besides the hanging tabs on the top, what I would do with it. I don't know. I'll have to think about that one. But anyway, so that's what I would say to you. Okay, another question I get, we'll move out of the Janome area. If you have more questions, feel free to put them in. But moving out of the Janome area into a more generic one, let me just say hi to Brenda. Hey, Brenda, good to see you with us too. Oh, sneaking, watching at work. People talk about spray basting their quilts, and I have a multi-purpose quilt spray. I think most of you are probably familiar with that already. And if you're not, you can go to my website and you can get the information and the recipe for it. And so what it is a spray basting, a basting spray, I should say, that you can use and make and use yourself. Oh my gosh, that you can make and use yourself to baste your quilt sandwiches together. And so people, you know, I get different questions about it, what to use and all this kind of stuff. Well, I got a question the other day that said, because I always recommend that you wash your quilts when you apply extra things to them, like if you're using 505 spray, for example, or you're using this multi-purpose quilt spray, I tell you should wash it out. Any extra products you add to your quilts, I think it's a good idea to wash them out of them, just to be on the safe side so it doesn't damage your fabric or, you know, attract bugs, which is what I'm going to talk about next. So because this is kind of an organic spray, it uses flour in it. Like organic isn't the right word, but you know what I mean. It's using flour in it, and so it could attract bugs. So this is one of the reasons why I tell you to wash it out. And this person was saying, well, we're asking what could happen if you don't wash it out. Well, I can't tell you exactly what might happen, but again, if you are living in a climate where it's humid, you could get mildew in there because the flour could mildew, you know, if it gets kind of damp. And also, it could attract bugs. I mean, I live in a dry climate. I don't have either of those issues, but I still think it's a good idea to wash it out because I don't know over time, you know, there's either rubbing alcohol in it or vodka. So, you know, it could damage the rubbing alcohol, could damage your fabric over time. I don't know that. I'm not a chemist. I didn't even take chemistry in high school, so I'm really not good at chemical things. But I would just suggest that you wash it out. So my biggest concern would be if you lived in somewhere quite humid and damp, you lived in Malaysia, for example, and you left your quilt bundled up and it still had that spray in it, when you open it up, you might find that it's gone mildewy or you might find that it attracts bugs for sure. So that's why I would suggest that you wash it out, is just so you don't have anything extra on your fabric or your batting that may cause some damage to your quilt. All right. Rob says buttonholes make beautiful heirloom looks in crazy quilts. Yes, I guess you could do that, couldn't you? Yes, you could. I think a buttonhole would be kind of cool if you're making, if you're doing like an applique and it looks like a little eye or something. You could put little eyelashes over top. It might look like a little half closed eye or something, maybe. I don't know. I'm gonna have to play with some buttonholes because there's certainly lots of buttonhole options on the Janome 9450, and I'm sure on some of the machines Rob has too, there's lots of different buttonholes. I never knew there were that many buttonholes, okay, because I don't do garment sewing. Okay, let's see what else people are asking about. Oh, and wondering, do you use my multi-purpose quilts? But I know Rob does for sure. Brandon, Deb, are you using that as well? Have you used it? And a lot of people use it and like it. I love the fact that I can whip it up whenever I need it and stuff. If I'm, you know, run out of it, and I can just make it up and stuff. As a matter of fact, I had to get more vodka the other day because that's what I'm using and making mine. I had to go get some more vodka. I was going to go buy more vodka because we were almost out at my house, and it was kind of a funny story because I was out with some friends. We were out shopping, and I was saying, "Oh, I've got to get some vodka on my way home because I need more to make up more multi-purpose quilt spray." And she says, "Oh, no, don't go buy vodka. I've got vodka in the house. We never use it." So, so she sent me home with, you know, a container of vodka, which I had to put in the back of the car because, you know, you can't carry open liquor. I thought that'd be just my luck, right? I get pulled over and I've got a mason jar of vodka in the car. I'm sure that would be an interesting discussion with the police officer. Anyway, so I thought, okay, well, that's great. So I just came home and had the vodka so I could make the spray, which was really nice of her, so I didn't have to go buy more. So it doesn't take a lot necessarily either, like about a cup, I think. I can't remember how much it is, but it's not much. So I thought, well, thanks. That saves me having to stop at the liquor store. Okay. Anyway, oh, here's a good question. I have to look at I have a list of them here. I have to look at my list so I can remember what people have asked me about. You know, we've been talking a lot about, sorry, free motion quilting and talking about ruler quilting. And when you're doing ruler quilting, which is basically free motion quilting with rulers, and some people call them templates, I think that's so you avoid getting mixed up between the rulers you use for cutting and the rulers you use for quilting because they're not the same. I think most of you probably know that. That the ones you use for quilting are thicker. You do not want to use your cutting rulers for quilting, okay? The normal cutting, acrylic cutting rulers for quilting. But there is an awful lot of rulers out there. There are an awful lot of rulers out there, I should say, and it can get really confusing. And you know, you can want to jump in, especially if they're on sale, right? Because they're not inexpensive. You may think, oh, I want to go get a whole bunch of these rulers. Well, don't do that. I would say don't do that because a couple of reasons. They're expensive, so don't go stocking up on a whole bunch that you may never use. Okay, that's the first thing. And secondly is if you haven't done any ruler quilting yet, you don't know whether you're going to like it or not. Okay, you don't know if you're going to like it, and you don't know, depending on what kind of quilt you make, whether it's something that you'll do a lot of. So you might find that you aren't doing ruler quilting on a lot of your quilts. You prefer to do more organic free motion quilting. So it would be a really waste of your money to go and buy a whole bunch of these rulers and then never use them, right? They don't go bad, at least they don't deteriorate. But you know, you don't need more stuff in your studio if it's not helpful for your quilting. So having said that, if you have done some ruler quilting and you like it, you've probably started with, you know, a straight line ruler. Most people start with a straight line ruler, and that's what I always recommend you do. This is one that came in the Janome kit that you can get, the ruler kit that you can get, which has, I think, 5 or 6 different rulers in it. One of these days I must count. But anyway, so, you know, just straight edge ruler, usually a short, you know, about 6 to 8 inch ruler I like to use because I have smaller hands and I don't want anything bigger than my hand. Like I can have a big long ruler, but I don't have control over that long ruler, right? So you want to use something that, in my way of thinking anyway, a smaller ruler is better than a bigger ruler because you have to keep, you want to be quilting, you want that ruler foot to be next to the ruler where you've got control. So next to your hand, okay? And once you're outrunning your hand, it's time to stop and move the ruler, get repositioned again, and start quilting along again. So what I suggest you get is a straight edge ruler. And it's not like this is a beginner ruler or anything like that. A straight edge ruler is something you're going to use a lot of, right? If you're doing cross hatching, for example, you're going to do that. If you want to do straight line, just straight lines along in your blocks, any kind of, you know, ruler quilting usually has, unless you're doing, you know, rounded shapes, there's a lot of designs you can make with a straight ruler. So that is going to be one of your staples in your rulers for quilting. Let me see here. This is the other one too. So I'll talk about that as a straight edge ruler, and then you can get the ditch rulers. Okay. And I'm sure you've seen some of these before, but if you're not really sure about what I'm talking about between these two rulers, like I'll talk about this as a straight edge ruler and I'll talk about this as a ditch ruler. It's called a ditch ruler. This is from Handy Quilter. And the difference you can see is the little bumps on the end. Okay. I like to have one of these ditch rulers because we often stitch in the ditch, right? And this is really handy for that. Why is it handy for that? Well, because when you have your ruler foot is a quarter, the edge of the foot is a quarter inch away from your needle, right? So when you actually use this ruler, let's say, this Janome ruler, and you have your ruler foot here, you're not actually stitching where the ruler is, you're stitching a quarter inch away from it. So you always have to kind of keep that in your mind, right? It gets confusing sometimes. When you use your little ditch ruler, you can take these little bumps and put them along the seam where you actually want to stitch or whatever area you want to stitch in. And when your ruler foot is in here, you are actually stitching here, okay? This is a quarter inch away from the inside, this indented area here. So if you always line up these little bumps, and then you know that when your foot is in here, you're going to be actually stitching in this area. Does that make sense to you? Hopefully that makes sense to you. Okay, so I would line up these bumps with my seam. Okay, and then when I put my ruler foot in there and I go along, I know I'm going to be stitching. My needle is actually going to be right at those, right along this area. Okay, not this area. So it makes it a lot easier to line up and find, and then you don't have to think about when you're using like this ruler, for example, you don't have to think, okay, I've got my ruler here, but I know I'm actually stitching a quarter inch away. I can just use the little bumps on the ditch ruler and I'll be stitching in the ditch with my foot then at that time. So these are really handy to have too. And there's all kinds of markings on. That's the other thing, right? I always say, I can never see these upside down or not for you guys. But anyway, there's all these markings on these rulers. When you want to get, when you're looking for a ruler, I always say look for markings, a quarter inch at least, quarter inch, half, you know, because you can use those and line them up with previously stitched lines. Or even if you want to line them up with your seam and you want to, like, say you're not stitching the ditch. Let's say you're lining up with a seam and you want to stitch, you know, an inch away or whatever. You've got the markings on the ruler to show you where that would be. Okay, so you could line up your ruler there and then stitch an inch away from a line or an inch and a half or whatever you want to do. But when you're doing several rows of stitching parallel to one another, that those lines, those markings on the ruler are really helpful. Okay, most of them will have them. It's just like Some have more than others. So this guy here, for example, you can see you've got 30 degree, 45 and 60 degree lines. There's some on the other one too, but so you really have to kind of look at them because like I say, there's an awful lot of rulers out there. The more lines and markings on the ruler, the better in my way of thinking, because you can do lots of different things with them. So for example, when you're using this ruler, you could have lines at those angles instead. You could do your cross hatching at those angles instead of just, you know, the 90 degree, you could have them off at 45 or 60 or what was the other one I said? 30. 30 is an interesting one too, but it just gives you more options on what you can do with the ruler. Because I always, when I look at buying accessories like this, I want the most bang for my buck, okay? So if the rulers are not inexpensive, they can be fairly pricey. I want to make sure I can do lots of different things with those rulers. And the other thing is it's helpful to look online because you'll find with different, certainly Handy Quilter, and some different quilters who have their own line of rulers out, they will have videos on them. So you can see what they do before you buy them. That's another thing. I love to research things. Maybe you don't do that like I do, but I love to research things before I invest in them. And getting rulers for ruler quilting is an investment, okay? So I would say you start off with these ones, with a straight edge ruler or a ditch ruler if you can get it. And then I would move up from there and start, you know, once you decide you like ruler quilting, if you want to venture out more, circles are always good to add next because you can do a lot of things with circles. They don't have to be a circle. They can be a half circle. They can make clamshells. They can do different things like that too. So, you know, the more things you can do with the rulers, the better it is. And the more use you'll get out of them and the less rulers you'll have to buy. Although it's kind of fun to have rulers in the studio. But, you know, again, you shouldn't have stuff in you're not using. I need to have that in the wall of my studio. Anyway, okay. Barbara, good to see you from Ontario too. We got the Ontarians in the house today, it looks like. Rob says, yeah, he's agreeing with that you need a short, having a short ruler is better because he bought an 8-inch straight ruler. Discovered ruler work was not my thing. Okay, and rulers are very expensive. Yes, I'm guessing you're talking about maybe trying out the rulers first, not the length of the ruler, sorry. So yeah, if you've got a friend who's got rulers, yeah, borrow the ruler from them and try it out and see what you think. Because, you know, it's just a different type of quilting, right? It's a different look for one thing. They're very precise, which is nice, but there's a lot of thinking that has to go in when you're using rulers, especially if you're not just doing simple straight lines. If you're doing some other, you know, clamshells or something, well, they may not all fit across your block you're quilting in or your quilt you're quilting in, so you have to move your template a bit so that you can get them to look proper. Like there's lots of thinking in them and marking too. You can, you know, when you're doing ruler quilting, I'm getting into a big discussion here, ruler quilting, but you know, often you're marking your quilt because you need to know where to line up your ruler next or where, you know, you need a starting area, especially if you're doing something on an angle. Well, what angle do I want to start it on and where am I starting from and that sort of thing. So you'll have a lot of reference marks on your quilt when you're doing ruler quilting as you get more advanced. So it's not for everybody. It is a different way of, a different style of quilting. And so, you know, you're either going to like it or you don't like it. And that's perfectly fine too, right? It's not for everybody. And just think, if it's not for you, think of the money you'll save on rulers. Okay. Let's see. What else are people asking? Oh, yes. Let me just have a drink of tea here. Okay. This is why I have this fabric sitting up behind me here. Because I get questions about, and I'm sure we all run into this, how do you cut your fabric so that you don't get, you know, that little V, especially when you're cutting strips, right? You can get that V. If your fabric isn't straightened up properly when you start, you can get this little wonky line in it, which is really not good. So I'm going to show you. First thing you have to do is you straighten your fabric, but let's step back even further than that. So when you're working with your fabric, okay, before you go to cut it, what are you going to do with it? You're going to, well, you might be saying wash it. Some of you, yeah. Some people wash their fabric. I don't always wash my fabric, but you can, if you want to do that, great. But you also want to iron it, right? Press it. You want to make sure that you've got the wrinkles and stuff out of it because you can't straighten your fabric or cut it properly if it's not pressed well, okay? So when you're pressing your fabric, I always say within reason, the stiffer it is, the better it is. The easier it is to cut, the more accurate the cutting will be, all those kinds of things. So you can use, spray starch if you've got it. Some people like to use Mary Ellen's Best Press. What I'm using lately, and I got the big thing here, is from Precision Piecing Products. Rob knows what I'm talking about, this Easy Press fabric treatment, and I've got the big gallon jug, okay, because I use a lot of it. It's more economical to buy it that way. And then I just take it and I put it in one of my little spray bottles, right, and just refill it when I need to. So I like to use that. So it puts it, you know, you spray it on your fabric, you iron your fabric, you know how to do that probably. And then when you've got it done, it's got more body to it, more stiffness to it. Especially, I'll just digress slightly, not just if you're cutting it, but if you want to use your fabric in a die cutter, the stiffer it is, the more paper-like it is, the better it'll cut with your die cutter too. So that's something else if you're using an AccuQuilt Go or you're using a Sizzix Big Shot Pro or a Cricut, one of the Cricut products, whatever you may be using there, the stiffer it is, the better it works, the better the cut is. Okay. But the other thing you want to do is when you get your fabric, this is cute little fabric I got. I want to use this in a book pillow. I got this from Studio 39 Fabrics. They're a Canadian company. If you're in Canada, check them out. And so you can see, because this has been sitting over there for a bit, looks a little bit wrinkled. Hey, does this look better? Let's see. Okay, so what you're going to do is you're going to match your selvedges together, right? I think most of you know this. But if you don't have, if the fabric is not laying smoothly down, okay, let me show you what I mean. If it's like this, so you can see, I'm never sure where the camera is here. There we go. I have to exaggerate so you can see it well. Make sure I don't drop my fabric here. Okay, so you can see that that fabric is not, you can see that it is not smooth, okay? Lying smoothly there. But if I move it over here, because when you get fabric and it's cut, it's not necessarily cut straight on the grain. Okay, that looks better. You see how it's hanging smoothly? Forget the little bit of wrinkles at the top there, but it's hanging smoothly. So when I lay it down and I go to cut it, it's going to cut without that V in the middle. But let's say you think it's all A-okay and everything, and you go to cut it, I want you to take that first strip that you cut off when you're straightening your fabric, you're gonna cut that first strip off, and I want you to open it up and lay it down on your cutting mat, smooth it out, and see, is it actually straight cut all the way along or not? Because even if you think it's straight, it might be off just a little bit. Okay, so you wanna check that first. I always check that first cut, because it's a lot better to check that first cut, which is a strip you're gonna throw away anyway, right? It's the raw edge off the end of the fabric. And if you don't check, and you just cut, you know, you straighten the edge of your fabric and you continue to cut 15 strips off it, let's say, and every single one of them has this in the middle and you want to use them from borders, that's going to be a big problem. You're going to end up having to hack up those strips and take out that little wonky part and seam them together, and it's not going to be a good thing. So take your time, make sure you press your fabric, make sure you starch it first, press it, straighten your edges, and then you're going to get nice straight cuts. But I always check that first cut, because, you know, you could be off just a little bit. It takes a little bit of practice sometimes. And sometimes it's hard to get off, like it's folded, it's on the bolt like this, right? And you'll have that line, right? When you get it, there's that line, my line's still there a little bit. You have that line there, and sometimes that's really hard to get off. So sometimes what I do before I put my spray starch on, if I'm thinking there's a real crease in there that I'm gonna have problems getting off when I press it, I will soak it down with water first and let it sit for a little bit. And then I'll put the spray starch on, and then I will go through and press it again. So I sometimes find I need to actually wet it to get the fabric to release enough so I can press it properly so it's going to work right, because sometimes it can be really stubborn to get that out. Okay. Does anybody else have any suggestions for that, actually? I'm wondering if anybody else has any suggestions for how to get rid of that V or how, anything that they do that would make it easier when you're cutting so that you avoid that. Just let me know. Terry, good to see you too. Terry's in town with me too, staying at home, keeping warm, I'm sure. Calgary. And Rob's, yeah, Rob used my basting spray for sure. Yes, it's good to use. Okay, moving on. Yeah, and if you've got, like I said, if you've got any questions as we go along, just type them in the chat so I can get to them. And if you have any suggestions or anything to add to what I'm saying, please feel free to jump in and give me your information too, because I always say, I don't know everything. And there's different ways of doing things too, of course, so. Okay, another question. We get into stabilizers. What's the best stabilizer to use for applique? And do you actually need stabilizer? Okay, well, this is a good question because I love applique. So I know about stabilizers and applique. Now, talking about stabilizers and applique, I think they're talking about raw edge applique, all right? Because when you do raw edge applique, you have to finish the edges with some kind of a stitch. A lot of times you might use a satin stitch on it, okay? Or you might use a buttonhole stitch, blanket stitch, those types of things, or some other decorative stitch. I like to use a little zigzag on it. So I think that's probably what they're talking about. And so whether or not you need a stabilizer is a really good question, actually, because sometimes you do and sometimes you don't. There's my answer. Okay, that's not very helpful, is it? Okay, so let's get into more details on that. when you're doing raw edge applique, you typically have, I'm gonna say typically because, you know, people do things different ways. Typically you have some fusible web behind your fabric, behind your applique. So, and the fusible web is left in, the glue part of it is left in the applique when you put it on your quilt project, on your background fabric. So there is already some stiffness in the applique. And certainly if you're layering several pieces on top, it can get quite stiff. So that may be enough to support the stitches that you put on the edges of the applique, but it might not be. So if you are using, and it depends on the product you use too, because some are softer than other products, okay? Some of the fusible webs you use can have a softer hand to them and they don't make the fabric as stiff. Typically, if I'm doing a zigzag, I like to use it's like an invisible stitch, like a little zigzag, a thin, wider space, little zigzag, so you don't see it much. And I find I don't need any stabilizer behind my background fabric to support that stitch because it's not a dense stitch, okay? But if you're using a satin stitch, which is also a zigzag stitch, right? But it's a dense, really close zigzag stitch, and it's typically wider than the ones I use too. That's a really dense stitch. And if you don't have a stabilizer behind your background fabric, you're gonna pucker up your fabric. So it's no different than, you can think of the same way as using decorative stitches on your, you know, just your regular fabric. If you're using decorative stitches, you need to have a stabilizer behind them because the fabric is not strong enough, if you wanna say that, to support those stitches because they're tend to be more dense. They're going over it themselves a couple times sometimes, and the fabric is just not stiff enough, even if you spray starched it, to hold those and support those stitches. So what will happen is the fabric starts to pucker up. So you'll see people going, I don't know why this happened. It's because you didn't put a stabilizer behind. And when you're talking about stabilizers in this type of application, I usually use a tearaway stabilizer. There's all different kinds of stabilizers, of course. And if you do machine embroidery like Rob does, you know, there's, you know, all about the stabilizers, right? But typically I use a tearaway stabilizer in an applique situation. And I like to have I call it a regular weight or lightweight stabilizer that I use for my appliques. If I need, like if I'm doing a satin stitch, one layer of stabilizer may not be enough of that weight of stabilizer. So then I will double them up. But I find it's better to have a lighter weight stabilizer. I use that more often. Usually just one layer of it's fine, than to have a heavyweight stabilizer that might be a bit of overkill in most situations. So that's what I would do, is I would double up if I need to. And in this case, when you're talking about applique, or really any time you're talking about decorative stitches in your projects, you should always try them on some scrap fabric first. Because again, if you are doing a decorative stitch and you put one layer of stabilizer underneath it, and you've got your applique on top and you're finishing that edge off, and then you're done and you go, uh-oh, it's pulled up the fabric, well, you're kind of in trouble now. It's very difficult. I have done it, but it's very difficult to pull out decorative stitches from around applique, you know, for a number of reasons, but it's not a good idea to do that. So it's better to try those stitches out, you know, take a small piece of fabric, you know, like you'll have, often you'll have offcuts from the applique because you'll put your fusible web behind the fabric and then you'll cut it out and stuff, and you'll have some of those little pieces left over afterwards. You could just use those, fuse them down on a scrap piece of fabric, try that decorative stitch you want to use, make sure you put your stabilizer behind first, sorry, and then try your stitch and see what's happening. Is one layer of stabilizer enough? If it was puckering up, probably not, so throw another layer in there. Typically, two layers will do it. I don't know if I've ever had to go to three, but you might have to, depending on how thin, how lightweight your stabilizer is. So yes, sometimes you need stabilizer when you're doing applique, raw edge applique. Sometimes you don't. If you're doing needle turn applique or hand applique, no. I would say no, you don't need to do that because you're doing handwork, right? And it's just fine, right? You can do hand embroidery, hand needlework, or stitches, I should say, around your applique, and you're not gonna need anything there because it's not that dense a stitch. It's not that heavy a stitch. So that's why. Also Rob says, yes, he's used the spray to starch his fabrics too, the multi-purpose quilt spray. Yes, you can do that as well. I'll be honest with you, I don't use it all the time. I do use it when I'm putting in my die cutter. I will use it for that and save my other spray. But I don't always use it that, but it works well that way too. The only thing I find occasionally when I'm using the multi-purpose quilt spray in that application as a spray starch, if you will, is sometimes if I don't have it shaken up enough, sometimes the flower will have little bits of dots of white, but you can brush those off or wet them and they'll come off. Okay, so let's see. Oh, and then of course, when you're talking about, we're just talking about thread and stitches and stuff, and people will often ask me, what's my favorite thread for quilting? Well, that's a really big subject. And I have lots of threads for quilting. So I go back and forth between using either polyester thread or cotton. Okay, I don't use rayon for quilting. Sometimes I use that for machine embroidery, but lately I'm going more the polyesters. So I use cotton or I use polyester. And of course, there's different weights of thread. So I mean, the fun part is there's all different kinds of thread you can try when you're quilting, right? And you'll find that there are certain ones that you will prefer and that you will find you're going to time and time again. So it's a bit of an experiment. And again, this is not a right or wrong thing at all. This is certainly just my opinion. Other people will have different opinions as well, and that's totally fine. Some of it depends on what machine you use, because some people find their machine doesn't like, you know, you say my machine doesn't like this thread. So whereas I can use a certain thread on my machine, no problem. Somebody else may find that their machine, it doesn't work as well on it. So that's fine too. You could work, you know, play with your machine a bit and try and get the tension changed and all that kind of stuff if you want to, or you can just go to another thread that works well with it and call it a day. That's sometimes a little less frustrating. So having said I use cotton and polyester, what kinds of threads do I use? Well, first off, I always tell people use a good quality thread. Okay, don't use, and I've said this before, don't use 20-year-old thread. You know, don't use cheap thread because you're going to have nothing but problems with it. It's going to be linty if it's cotton. It's going to have thread breaks. It's just not going to work very well. So you didn't spend all the time and money on your fabrics and your quilt to cheap out when it comes to the thread. It doesn't make sense. Thread is probably the cheapest part of what you pay to make a quilt. So don't cheap out. Get good quality threads. So good quality threads. Mettler, Aurifil, Superior Threads, Glide. I'm going to talk about Glide here. There's, you know, these are just some of the brands I'm throwing out here. Presencia, you know, Presencia makes cotton threads. So there's all different ones here, but you'll see people talking about those brands over and over and over again. You'll see blog posts on them, or you'll go to websites and have information on them. So you'll see the same names popping up over and over and over again. So good quality threads are easy to find. They don't cost you much more than cheap threads, and I guarantee you'll have less frustration and a better result if you use them. Okay. Now that you've been schooled on that, let's look at some of them. So I like to use, when I first started quilting, especially on my long arm, I like to use a lot of King Tut thread. So this is King Tut. It's a cotton thread. It's a 30 weight from Superior Thread. They're variegated threads. And I am not someone who uses a lot of yellow in my quilts. I'm not really keen on yellow, to be quite honest with you, but I have used this color called Sunstone in a lot of my quilts. I don't know why, but it has worked for a lot of the colors I use in my quilts. And I've gone through a cone or more of this already. I'm into this one a bit. So I like that. But that's a 30 weight thread. And it's a cotton. Also talking about Superior Threads, they have So Fine. This is, I have to look sometimes, remember, 40 weight polyester. It looks like cotton. It's a matte kind of polyester. It's not as shiny as some of them. It's a bit of a sheen, but not as shiny. It's variegated too. But that's a 40 weight, so a little thinner. So Fine. I also like to use, I mentioned Glide. I'm using Glide a lot these days. Glide is a polyester. It comes in a 40 or a 60 weight, and it has more of a sheen to it. You can see that sheen on it. It runs nicely in my domestic machine. It runs really nicely on my long arm as well. It also comes in, here's another color, comes in lots of pretty colors too. This is a one I got recently. I love all the pretty colors. I'll talk about that in just a second. It also comes in a 60 weight, but only in limited color. So some of the neutrals comes in a 60 weight. But how do I make my choices when I'm using different threads? Well, a few things. First off, sometimes I'm looking for a specific color that I can't get in one of the brands I just talked about. There's that, of course. But I'm looking to see whether I want my quilting to show or not. So if I want my quilting to show, I'm going to go with a heavier weight thread. So like the King Tut threads, for example. A 30 weight or a 40 weight even. If I don't want it to show, I'm going to go with a polyester is not as thick a thread typically as the cottons. So I'll go with a 40 weight or a 50 or 60 weight polyester. I go to my Glides all the times. And of course the color makes a difference as well. So I recently bought quite a few Glide threads because they run really nice and I like them. And I wanted to stock up on neutrals. I love color, okay? I love colors and bright colors like this, but the reality is that I don't use those colors in my quilt most of the time. I'm going to be using like a cream shade, a tan, khaki, grays even, like grays. That's what I'm using most of the time in my quilts because A lot of times I'm just wanting to add texture. If I've got lots of color and pattern and design going on my quilt, I don't want to distract and take away from that by putting a bright color in the quilting. It's just going to fight with each other. It's not going to work well. So I find that I'm going more and more to these neutrals and using those in my quilting. So, you know, you may think, okay, great. So you get a cream, you get a, you know, a gray, you get a white, and you're good. No, because you'd be surprised at how many different creams there are, tans there are. I'm trying to see if I've got another one over here. Actually, I don't have it out right now, but like this is linen, for example, and there's a cream, and there's 10 that are just slightly off. And then also the undertones on them, especially when you come to grays, you'll notice that there's a real difference in the undertones. So you're going to have a warm gray or a cool gray. And in the glide threads, for example, they'll have several different cool grays, like 3 or 4 different cool grays. And it's not until you actually put them together, put the thread spools together, that you can go, oh yeah, I can see this is a warm undertone, this one has a cool undertone. And you really notice that when you go to try them out on your quilts. So when you try them out, you unspool a whole bunch of thread, you lay it across your quilt, you see what it looks like, right? And when you do that, you know, I'll use a gray and I'll look at it and I'll go, oh, it's just not working right. It's the wrong tone. You can tell right away. Surprising, actually. But, you know, that's why I'm stocking up on some of these other ones. And another color is khaki, which is kind of a greeny gray. It's subtle, too. You'll find that blends a lot in your fabrics, too. If you use, like, say, if you're using Civil War reproduction fabrics, that's probably a really good color to have in stock. So much as I like the bright colors, and I do have some of them, I'm finding as I've learned more in my quilting that I am not using those nearly as much in the actual quilting of my projects. If I was doing a whole cloth, oh yeah, that'd be lots of fun. But, you know, our kids' quilts and stuff, you can use the colors I find more, but I'm finding that the neutrals are working quite a bit better, actually. And so I want to make sure I've got those on stock. So when they go on sale, then I will buy some and fill in, you know, the gaps that I have. So I've got that array of colors because I'm telling you, you know, I'll have 3 or 4 different creams out there, and it's amazing how different they look when you put them on your quilt. But as long as I've got some to choose from, I can always find one that works. So that works really well too. And you guys have, if you've got any favorites that you like to use, what kind of threads do you like to use on your quilts? I mean, I know people have preferences, and sometimes it comes down to what you can get in your area as well. Because sometimes, I mean, we can order online and everything, but if you've got a local shop and they stock, you know, like my local shops now are stocking glide they didn't used to before, but they do now, so it makes it really easy for me to get. Before, I would buy it at shows because that's the only place I could find it easily. And the thing with threads is because you have these subtle differences in them, it's kind of difficult to buy them online sometimes because it's hard to tell what color it's going to actually be when you get it, right? Again, especially with these cream colors, you know, like it's really difficult to see the differences online depending on your monitor too. So it's nice if you can go to your local shop and pick them up and know exactly which colors you want. Having said that, when you find colors that work well, make sure you make note of which ones those are so that you can remember and get more if you need to later on if you start running low on them. So hello, Karen. Good to see you from down south here, a little south and west of me here from Washington. Hopefully it's warmer down there than here. Not sure what's happening there now. Anyway, so those are some of the ones I like to use. There's also, we also have Wonderfill here in Calgary too, and I've used some of their products. They have an Invisifill that's 100 weight that works really well in the quilt. Unfortunately, my long arm machine doesn't seem to like it very much. I can't seem to get it to run on there, so I go to other brands. You know, you can get, I think there's a micro quilter you can get as well. I think that's 100 weight. I'm trying to remember now. I get the names mixed up occasionally, but Superior Threads, I like Superior Threads a lot. I like their colors. And I like their lines. They have all different kinds of thread weights and cottons or polyesters or whatever. They have different, can't even think of the word. Help me out here. What's in them, you know, is different, right? So they have lots of different choices there too. They're also good for their bottom line. I don't have it out here right now. It's a thinner weight thread. It's polyester. And that works really well to wind on your bobbins and use in your bobbins when you're doing decorative stitches, for example. I like to use bottom line in my bobbins sometimes. And Glide also has pre-wound bobbins too. They have pre-wound bobbins in 2 different sizes, the M and L. So one of them, I always get them mixed up. One is the bigger one. I think it's the M is the bigger one. So some machines take that, but your long arms are where you use those typically. They hold more thread, but they have pre-wound bobbins and they work really well too. As a matter of fact, I just bought some. Let me show you. They don't come in every color. And Glide's made by Filtec, by the way, F-I-L-T-E-C. So this is one I want to use. Yeah, the L is for my machine, my Janome. And I'm trying to look at the color on this guy. This is cream. So this is linen, but you know, this is cream. So they don't have every color in it, but you can see all those little bobbins in there, right? They don't have, they come in a nice little, like they come in this container and everything, which is really cool. I think it's cool. And they don't have anything on them, right? They've got a paper core in them, but they don't have anything on them. They don't have any paper or anything. Some of them will have something on the outside of them, but they don't. But you're not going to have much left when you're done with that bobbin, so it's going to be not much of a waste. It's recyclable, I'm sure. And there is, I'm trying to think how many are in here, because there's a bunch of them. Doesn't even tell you. They're called Magna Glide Delights. And there are 20 bobbins in there. So I've got quite a few, so I'm wanting to use those on my Janome, see how that works when I'm using the glide threads for my quilting. So I like that you can get those. And like I say, you got cream color. I think they come in grays as well. There's, I think, about three or four different colors they come in. So I could certainly use these with any of my lighter color threads and get the gray for any of the darker ones, and they would work just fine. So, oh yes, Rob's talking about the silk threads you can get from, you can get from Superior Threads. Yes, and I have some of those as well. Silk thread is nice, nice and thin as well. Beautiful to work with. More expensive, of course, because it's silk, but you know. Candlewick 3000 colors, similar to antique white, blends with almost everything. Yeah, if you can find those colors, those neutral colors that work well with all your quilt, like you'll find that there's a color you go, oh my gosh, it goes with the fabrics I like to use, right? Because we all have our kind of favorite colors that we use or styles we use of fabric. And so if you can get a color that works well with it, then you can just go to that color all the time and makes it really easy for you too. So yes, and Rob's used the pre-wound, but I haven't used any of the pre-wound bobbins yet in my machine, go figure, but I'm sure they work just fine. And I gotta say, you get kind of spoiled, right? When you use pre-wound bobbins, because you know, you just have them on hand, just pop them in. It's so great. And as a long armer, when you use your long arm machine, because you go through thread a lot quicker, your bobbin thread, I should say, well, both your threads, but your bobbin thread a lot quicker, you're never quite sure how much thread you need to use on your project. And it's a real pain to have to stop partway through and to wind a bobbin in any case, whatever machine you're using. So if you've got the pre-wounds and you run out of bobbin thread, just pop it in. It's so much quicker and so much more efficient for you too. So I kind of like that. But you get spoiled with them, yeah, for sure. Okay, let's see here. I think that was about all the questions that I had, the ones I could pick up recently that I get from people without getting into vintage sewing machines, which I don't think we really want to get into there because I get lots of questions on them. That's whole other topic. So if you guys have any questions, type them in. If not, I will be shutting it down here soon. But I do want to mention that I think you guys are chatties already, but if you're watching a replay and you're not a chatty and you want to join us in my Facebook group, those are members from my Facebook group, then you can do that. And I'm going to see if I've got my link here, because I'm never sure which link is what here. I do have links, but it doesn't tell me. There we go. Look at that. I managed to hit the right one. So if you want to join us as a chatty, you can go to this link and we'll be glad to have you in there. We have over 3,000 people in there right now. And we talk, of course, quilting all the time. So if you want to talk quilting with us, and there's a lot of Janome people in there, it's not Janome exclusive at all, but there are a lot of Janome people in there. So if you want to join us, we'd love to have you in there. And then the other thing I was talking about earlier about the Quilter's Way is we have something coming up right now, and Rob will know about this. We have a fabric challenge coming up, fabric SOS challenge. Sort, organize, and store your fabrics. We're starting a new year. We're starting a new decade. It's time to get our fabrics in order. I'm seeing a lot of people have fabrics left over all over the place from creating things for the holidays. I see people who are moving or setting up their sewing studios or their quilting studios, and they want some help. So we are doing a challenge. So what we're doing is we're working with your fabric yardage to start with, and we're going to show you how to sort through it so that you can declutter if you need to. And we're going to talk about ways of storing it that'll be helpful for you. And it's just a way to get yourself going for the new year, right? So registration, I should say, opened just today for that. So if you want to join us in that, let me just put up the link for that. And if you're a member of TQW, you don't have to worry, because you can join us automatically, basically, if you want to. Totally optional, of course, if you're a member. But if you are not a member yet in TQW and you want to get in on this challenge, if you use this link here, that will put you in there. There is a fee for it. There's videos every day that, not every day, I shouldn't say that, every step, because some steps take more than one day. But we have videos that go in there. We're going to be live during that challenge as well. So it's actually being held in the Quilter's Way. So if you're not already a member and you want to sign up for the challenge, you'll be able to be in there for a month. So you can see everything else we have in there too, full of all kinds of information and lots of fun members like Rob, of course. So if you want to do that, we'd love to have you in the challenge. It's going to be lots of fun. It gives me a chance to get things cleaned out too, because I'm feeling a little overwhelmed. I find if I don't have my studio and my fabrics in good order, I start feeling overwhelmed pretty quickly and I'm not nearly as productive. So having your fabrics all set up properly and only having the fabrics that you really like and will work with in your studio is going to make you more efficient and more productive and enjoy your quilting more, of course. And that's what it's all about, right? We like to enjoy our quilting, and you make lots of new friends as well. That's the other thing. So yes, enrollment opens today. You may, if you're on my email list, you may already have gotten an email about that. So we'd love to have you join us there. It's going to be lots of fun. Let's see here. Karen's also saying here she has, she has wood heat in her house. Well, then it'd be like Calgary, probably just normally. like to put your fabric on shelves. Should I put them in plastic containers? I would be more worried about my fabric being damp, like in a humid climate, than worried about it being dry, really. Just my personal opinion, because Calgary's really dry. I do have my fabrics, you can see behind me, on shelves, but behind doors, I should say. And the reason they're behind doors is just because of the cats in my studio. I don't want the fabric to have cat fur. I don't want them to get in there. As soon as I open a door, Victor's always trying to get into the fabrics, because I'm sure he'd love to lie in there and go to sleep, right? So I don't know that I would worry about that so much. Actually, keeping things in plastic containers, people will tell you not to put your quilts, not to store your quilts in plastic containers, because they can get damp and that type of thing in them. So if you're worried about them getting, if you're worried about them being dried out, I don't think that's a concern. If you're worried about them, like if there's a smell from the wood stove, I don't know that there is. If that's what you're worried about, you might want to put them behind, you know, in containers or behind doors, like what I have mine in. I don't know. Anybody else comment on that? Let me know what you think about that, because I don't have that kind of heat. I have a gas fireplace upstairs, but I don't have a wood stove. I live in a very dry climate, so it's very dry in our house. As a matter of fact, I'm getting shocks right now because it's so cold. We have a humidifier. You have to have a humidifier in Calgary typically. And I'm getting shocks off of everything. I'm getting shocks off of everything. I touch the cats because I'm like that. I'm just an electrifying person, you know. So I get shocks off the cats when I touch them. I get, like, taking things out of the dryer is a real challenge for me, because as soon as I go to pull them out, I'm getting static electricity. I'm getting major shocks. I mean, see the spark kind of shocks is what I'm getting off my dryer these days. Hurts. Anyway, even when I touch the fabric, sometimes I'm getting shocks off it. So we're in a dry place out here, and I don't know what it is with me, but I just get static electricity is really bad with me. So Karen, that's all I can say to you. If anybody else has any suggestions on there, certainly jump in and let Karen know what you think about that. I don't have a wood stove, so I can't really answer on that one. But I think the concern with fabrics is typically humidity and moisture more than dryness. Hopefully that helps. okay, so I think that's about it for today. Like I said, if you're interested in joining the fabric challenge, go to the link, check it out, see what we're doing. Rob is also telling us he stores his stuff in plastic containers under the bed because he's in a very small area. He puts a piece of cedar in. Okay, I haven't heard about that, but that's like a cedar chest, right? Same sort of idea, maybe? We should all have cedar chests in our studio to store our fabric in. That'd be great. To manage the humidity, see, because he is where he is, near the ocean in the Netherlands, you have to worry more about the humidity. So isn't it interesting how we have different concerns depending on the climate we live in? It's kind of fascinating, actually, I think. So while I talk about having a concern about things being dry, other people going, oh my gosh, you know, we're in such a humid climate here, there's other problems. So yeah, kind of interesting. All right, I need to move on because I've got more things to do this afternoon, quilting-wise. I actually have a client I have to talk about. I'm doing some coaching, so I have a client that I have to deal with, a client I'm working with this afternoon, because I love working with her. And so I need to get ready for that. So I'm going to have to say goodbye for today. I'll see you again on the third Thursday in February. I'm not even sure what date that is, but it'll be after Valentine's Day probably. So again, join me in the Chatterbox Quilts Facebook group. Check out the challenge and see what you think about that. If you want to get your studio in order, that's the way to do it. Get your fabrics in order for sure and get off on the right foot for 2020. And I'll see you either in the Quilter's Way or in my Chatterbox Quilts Facebook group or live next time on the third Thursday in February. So I hope you have a great quilting day, and I will see you later.